of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee on ending conversion practices. I'd invite members who wish to participate to press the request speak buttons now as soon as possible or place an R in the chat function, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee for around 10 minutes, please, Mr Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to open this debate as convener of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee and to be able to set out the findings of our report on petition PE1817 entitled End Conversion Therapy. The terms conversion therapy and conversion practices are used interchangeably in the report to reflect the wording used by the petitioners and witnesses. However, the committee's preference is to use the term conversion practices. We consider this to be more accurate. The word therapy is typically used to convey a benefit, but the evidence that we heard was clear. There is nothing beneficial about so-called conversion therapy for those individuals who are subjected to it. The committee heard that current protective legislation is insufficient to prevent these harms taking place. Our report is clear that conversion practices are abhorrent and are not acceptable in Scotland. They should be banned. Presiding Officer, public petition PE1817 was lodged in August 2020. It was referred to the Session 5 Equalities and Human Rights Committee, which indicated in its legacy report that it should be taken forward for consideration by its successor committee. Our committee agreed to undertake an inquiry on the issues raised by the petition, and we launched our call for views, which ran from the 6th of July to the 13th of August 2021. We received around 1,400 responses, predominantly from individuals. The committee held 8 evidence sessions. In addition, we held private, informal sessions with individuals who had experienced conversion practices. On behalf of the committee, I would like to thank all those who gave evidence, both in writing and orally. In particular, I'd like to thank those individuals who provided testimony of their experience as victims and survivors of conversion practices. It took immense courage to recount these experiences. Committee members found these testimonies harrowing, but they were invaluable to our work. The key issues identified in our evidence upon which there was a key issue which was identified in our evidence on which there was broad agreement, including from those in support of a ban and from those who expressed concerns, was the need for a clear definition of so-called conversion therapy or practices. The term is generally understood to refer to practices that demonstrate an assumption that any sexual orientation or gender identity is inherently preferable to any other, and which attempts to bring about a change of sexual orientation or gender identity, or seeks to suppress an individual's expression of sexual orientation or gender identity on that basis. The committee recommends that the definition used in the report on conversion therapy by the UN Independent Expert on Protection Against Violence and Discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity should be adopted. The committee is anxious to ensure that in a similar way to legislation that exists to protect victims of domestic abuse or female genital mutilation, the definition of conversion practices in forthcoming legislation makes it clear that consent to such practices can never be informed and should not be available as a defence to those undertaking conversion practices. Presiding Officer, the majority of religious organisations that we heard from are in favour of a ban on conversion practices. The committee agrees that legislation should not pose any restriction on ordinary religious teaching or the right of people to take part in prayer or pastoral care or discussion, to discuss, explore or come to terms with their identity in a non-judgmental and non-directive way. However, we heard evidence that most conversion practices take place within a religious setting, including in the form of talking therapy, which is used with the intention of correcting sexuality or gender. The committee believes and recommends that such practices should fall within a ban. The committee heard persuasive evidence from many survivors of conversion practices that their faith is part of their identity and they have felt forced to choose between faith and their sexual orientation or gender identity, which can have a devastating impact. The committee believes it is vital to involve religious and community leaders as legislation progresses, and that education and awareness is crucial to promote acceptance of diversity. We recommend that the Scottish Government engages with a wide range of faith and belief organisations in order to protect LGBT people and address concerns around protecting religious freedom. The committee agrees there is no conflict in protecting religious freedom and protecting and preventing harm by putting a ban in place. The committee notes that the majority of healthcare bodies in the UK have signed up to the Memorandum of Understanding, a joint document signed by health, counselling and psychotherapy organisations, including NHS Scotland, which aims to end the practice of conversion therapy in the UK. One witness told us that they were aware of a limited number of instances of alleged conversion practices in medical settings and would wish to see a ban on this where there is an intention to change someone's sexuality or gender identity. The committee agrees that affirmative therapies, where individuals are seeking support and a space to explore their identity in a non-directive setting where no set or preferred outcome is intended, should be protected under the ban. We heard evidence, however, that there is some confusion and misunderstanding around the term affirmative therapy, and it would be helpful for clarity to be provided to the medical profession, counselling services and wider society on this. Excuse me. Concerns were expressed to the committee about the rights of parents to bring up their children in a way that is consistent with their moral and religious beliefs. The committee believes that there is a clear distinction to be made between parents having the right to bring up their children in line with their morals and values and having the directed intent to change their child's sexuality or gender identity. The committee agrees that any proposal should not pose restrictions on parents or schools to provide a safe space for discussion and exploration, but should prohibit harmful practices which attempt to change a person's sexual orientation or gender identity. Presiding Officer, the UK Government has indicated its plans to publish draft legislation in the spring of this year, which would cover England and Wales. The committee agrees that Scotland should not wait for the UK legislation to be brought forward and considers that within the powers available to the Scottish Government and Parliament, Scotland-specific legislation should be brought forward as soon as possible. The committee welcomes the Scottish Government's commitment to bring forward legislation by the end of 2023 and the establishment of the expert advisory group to inform and develop policy. We recognise that work will be necessary to ensure the development of cross-border frameworks, and we call on the UK Government to work with the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament on a ban. The committee agrees that prospective legislation should set out a fully comprehensive ban on conversion practices and should cover sexual orientation and gender identity, including trans identities. It should cover adults and children in all settings without exception, and include so-called consensual conversion practices. The committee recommends that any ban should also include a ban on the advertising and promotion of conversion practices. The committee heard strongly expressed views that legislation alone would not be sufficient to address conversion practices and that non-legislative measures would also be necessary to protect and support victims. The committee heard a broad range of suggestions for supportive measures which could complement legislation. In paragraphs 154 to 157 of the report set some of these out in detail. The committee noted concerns around how enforcement of a ban could be effective and believes that consideration should be given to how this role could be fulfilled by a public body to ensure investigation, enforcement and accountability is possible. The committee is keen to ensure that time is not wasted gathering identical evidence from the same victims that we heard from during our private evidence sessions, which may also have the unintended consequence of re-traumatising victims. We therefore ask the Scottish Government to work with the committee in this regard. The committee is mindful of the volume of evidence that is already available, including the written and oral evidence it has received, and we consider that it is important to bring forward legislation promptly. In a report, we stated that we would welcome discussions with the Scottish Government on working together to bring forward a ban as quickly as possible, and I welcome the Minister's letter of the 10th of March offering to progress discussions with the committee on next steps and look forward to that further engagement. On behalf of the committee, I would also like to thank the Minister and her officials for their detailed response that they have provided in relation to each of our recommendations, and including the assurances that these will be progressed through the work of the expert advisory group. Presiding Officer, in closing, I would like to again highlight once more the impact of the sessions that we held with individuals who had experienced conversion practices. Whilst the formal written and oral evidence we received helped our consideration of the actions being called for in the petition, it was the testimony of each of those individuals that really impressed upon us the need for legislation to be brought forward as soon as possible. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Fitzpatrick. A gentle reminder to anyone who does want to participate in the debate, they do need to press the request to speak buttons. And with that, I call Christina McKelvey, Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Okay, thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be opening today's debate on the report on the petition to end conversion therapy. I want to be clear from the outset that it is essential we act now to end conversion practices in Scotland. These practices, as we have heard, are harmful, discriminatory and have no place in our society. There is no credible evidence to suggest that conversion practices can change a person's sexual orientation or gender identity. There is, however, very clear evidence of the serious harm that these practices cause and evidence that these practices are still taking place today. I want to end these practices once and for all and make sure that everyone, regardless of their sexual orientation or gender identity, is safe from conversion practices in Scotland, free to be themselves. This debate is taking place as a result of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee's report on the petition to end conversion therapy, which was published on the 25th of January this year. I welcome this report and have written to Jo Fitzpatrick, the committee convener, noting my appreciation for the committee's detailed and sensitive work in this space and addressed how the Scottish Government will approach their findings as we push forward with determination to end these practices. We hope to work closely with the committee on progressing our approach to a ban and will consider how we can best do this together. And I want to offer and reassure the committee convener and members of the committee that I'm keen to do that. The committee's findings form, in my opinion, a cornerstone of our understanding of conversion practices in Scotland, in particular the accounts from survivors and those with lived experience of these terrible practices. I would like to thank those too who gave evidence to the committee, especially those who shared their own experience of conversion practices. Their bravery for stepping forward and telling their stories is not only vitally important, it is admirable and courageous. They will help us to reshape the future, and I thank them for that. Certainly.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Minister for giving way. As we've heard, the committee noted that many religious organisations that they heard from were in favour of a ban on conversion therapy practices, although clearly views were varied. It is therefore important that we make always clear that these measures are not about restricting religious teaching or preaching. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that in seeking to end the demonstrably harmful effects of the so-called therapies that we're talking about, it's important that we get representation from a broad range of religious and other organisations in order to achieve the best possible legislation?
Minister, I can give you the time back.
Can I thank Alistair Allen for that intervention and respond to him? I've got a number of points through my speech today that will answer many of his questions and hopefully reassure him. But what I want to say in response is we do recognise the existing legal protections of the rights to freedom of religion, expression, private and family life, amongst others, and the expert advisory group will explore how legislation can best protect and support those who need it while ensuring that freedoms are safeguarded. And I will come on to that after I've explained a bit about the expert advisory group and who will be on it. As you know, Presiding Officer, the establishment of the expert advisory group on banning conversion practices was announced last November by the Social Justice Cabinet Secretary as a means to inform our approach to banning conversion practices as far as possible within our devolved competence. We want the membership of the group to be as intersectional and as representative as possible, whilst ensuring a focus on actions and outcome given at the pace they will be working, because it will be a short-term working group. Therefore, the membership includes individuals who are experts in their fields from LGBTI organisations, faith and belief organisations and their communities, mental health, the law, human rights and academia. And importantly, there will be members who have personal lived experience of conversion practices on that group too. On the timings for that group, we are planning to convene the first meeting of the Expert Advisory Group on Banning Conversion Practices at the end of this month. The Short Life Group will work until the summer, when they will report their findings and recommendations to the Scottish Government. Following this, we will begin a process of public consultation, which will run through to the autumn. A bill team will then be set up to look towards introducing legislation by the end of 2023. Our expert group will work at pace, as I've said. They will consider all relevant evidence that is currently available, including the committee's response, the UK Government's consultation responses and other existing research, to ensure these harmful practices are banned. One of the questions that we've been asked, and it was asked in the committee inquiry too, was around about definition. I know there's a lot of questions around that. So a key aspect for the consideration of the expert group will be determining what practices should be prohibited. I agree with the committee that clarity is needed on what would be encompassed by a legislative ban. It must be crystal clear for both organisations and individuals to understand not just their responsibilities, but the protections that are in place too. Certainly.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you for taking the intervention. Could you set out how you see the expert group working with the evidence already gathered by the committee?
Minister.
Most definitely. I think some of the work that we'll do with the expert group will be to allow them to work out how they want to take some of that forward as well. In the first meeting, we'll set those terms of reference in the work that they want to do. I think there's a lot of work there. We are really keen for the group not to do double the work. So a lot of already the committee's done a huge piece of work, and that's why I've described it as the cornerstone of our work going forward. There's lots of academic study there as well, and the group themselves were in the process of issuing those invitations. There's a lot of people who had to have a bit of thought about joining the group as well, so we want to make sure that they're all in place, and I'll be able to announce who the group is, and you'll see from the breadth and the depth of that that they'll be able to respond to some of the real challenges that we see in this, but also, you know, come up with the ideas and the resolutions and how to fix it as well. Presiding Officer, a ban will bring an end to those abhorrent practices that seek to correct sexual orientation and gender identity. This view is echoed by the Memorandum of Understanding on Conversion Therapy in the UK, which supports positive practices that assist individuals as they explore and accept their gender identity and sexual orientation at their own pace. The expert group will explore what this means fully, taking into account established definitions from organisations such as the UN, as well as looking into definitions from foreign jurisdictions. And I would hope that would be another answer to Pam Duncan-Glancy's question there about the areas where we will explore. Just turning to faith and belief, because I know there's a lot of concerns and issues and questions that have been raised around this. I want to be absolutely clear that whilst we build our understanding on how we can best protect and support those who are experiencing these horrendous practices, we must be mindful that freedoms, including freedom of speech, religion and belief, are safeguarded. The Scottish Government welcomes and acknowledges the importance of engaging with faith and belief organisations, which is why the expert group's membership includes faith and belief representatives. Certainly.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the member for that. It is very important that religious and faith groups are involved in this whole process, because they have a right to have their say in this. So can I ask the minister what views will be taken from the group itself as to what will be achieved and how they will be managed, because it's quite a delicate situation to try and balance.
Minister, if you could begin.
I absolutely agree with Alexander Stewart, Presiding Officer. It is a delicate situation to balance, and we're very mindful of that and very sensitive to that. I think we'll take a lead from the work that the committee did and how sensitive and balanced the work the committee have done on this. So we will come from that point of view. But it's clear that there are concerns. And it's clear that there's potential impacts on religious freedom, and we will ensure that those are considered extremely carefully and sensitively, as I said. But we are also certain that the advancement of LGBTI rights and protections through ending conversion practices does not mean a regression of religious freedoms. We are mindful of the existing legal protections of the rights to freedom of religion and expression, amongst others. And as highlighted by Jen Ang of Just Right Scotland, when giving evidence to the committee, it is essential that we nurture and promote safe spaces within religious communities and support appropriate pastoral care, as for some of it is in a religious setting where they would best be able to access a non-judgmental and supportive environment in which to explore their gender identity and sexual orientation. Presiding Officer, I think I've taken quite a few and I'm just about finished. I'm sorry, but maybe come in the summing up. Presiding Officer, just a quick point on healthcare. I also want to ensure that mental health services, religious bodies and other professionals are properly supported to provide appropriate services to people seeking help and advice in relation to their sexual orientation or gender identity. Representatives from specialist healthcare services on the expert group will be able to share their views, including on capacity building needed in the sector. They will also provide the necessary curriculum updates and training to provide support for mental health professionals, enabling them to do their jobs effectively and with confidence. So a holistic approach on this. Presiding Officer, to conclude, I welcome the committee's suggestions on non-legislative measures which need to be brought forward to protect and support victims. I'm glad that there is an acknowledgement that significant resource and planning would be required to do so. The expert group will consider these suggestions as well as investigate further what possible protections and support could be offered to victims and survivors.
I want to be absolutely clear,
the conversion practices have no place in Scotland, and I welcome hearing the Chamber's views on the committee's report and the measures we need to take to push forward with ending these abhorrent practices. Presiding Officer, thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'm afraid we are slightly behind the clock now, so interventions will have to be incorporated into speeches. I now call on Alexander Stewart for around 6 minutes, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to open this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. I welcome that this issue has been given parliamentary time this afternoon, a view which I am sure will be shared amongst my members of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. The case for introducing a ban on conversion practice has been one of the key works that the committee have focused on during this parliamentary session. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the many individuals, charities and campaign groups who provided evidence to the committee on this issue. But in particular, Presiding Officer, I'd like to take the time to talk about the individuals who were willing to share their own experiences of conversion practices. It was hard to hear and hard for them to do. I remember clearly one of the survivors from the practices describing conversion therapy as both horrendous and threatening, and spoke of how badly his mental health suffered because of it, something which almost drove him to a nervous breakdown. It will no doubt come as no difficult situation and circumstances that personal testimonies of trauma is very important, and we had and we did receive some very trying testimonies. Indeed, the testimonies were not easy for witnesses, as I've said, to give us, but I give them full respect for the attitude they had and the courage they had in bringing these testimonies to the committee and ensuring that we heard firsthand how they had been treated and how the abhorrent practices took place. These benches are therefore clear that we need to look forward to a ban on conversion practices. And much of the evidence that we heard at committee points to a comprehensive approach of a ban being preferred. For example, some medical professionals spoke about the possibility of a less comprehensive ban resulting in loopholes, which would and could cause some concerns going forward. In the respect of the clear proposals that were put forward, they should mirror existing bans on such areas as female genital mutilation, in the fact that the possibility to ensure that there will have to be some legal content for these practices. However, whilst I welcome the comprehensive ban on these practices, it is perhaps disappointing that we've taken a bit of slow progress to get here. And I acknowledge the fact that the Scottish Government has established advisory capacity and the committee. And I'm delighted that we've heard some clarity on where we are with that, because it was back in November and we're now in March. So there's been some time, Minister, but I'm delighted that you've clarified today as to how that is going to take place. Because our committee was clear that the Scottish Government should not wait for the UK Government to act before putting forward legislation, and we've now had confirmation that the UK government ban will only apply to England and Wales. So despite having that, it's important that we, as I say, go forward and talk about the possibilities of cross-border frameworks on the issue that will no doubt be important. And the UK Equalities Minister, Mike Fear, has given assurances that the UK Government will work constructively with the Scottish Government in attempting to bring in the ban on conversion practices and the therapy. Given that the truly comprehensive ban will include criminalisation of practicals and also falling into that, it's very important that there will be clear legislation that will fall here in the devolved areas, and that's important. Presiding Officer, the time to act is now, not later, but now, and further steps need to be taken to ensure that that becomes the case. Given the consensus that the ban has had and the practices needed for the government, we should be looking at ensuring that we are moving forward on this at pace, and I look forward to seeing that take place. There are already international examples of how such a ban has taken place and is working across. Now, we know that our 13 countries have already introduced a ban on some of the forms that wish to Elkin, and I welcome the government has stated that it will consider existing practices where the ban has taken place, and Scotland itself wants to ensure that it has that opportunity. So regardless of the importance of going forward, while the UK Government is going through its own process for its legislation, the Scottish Government should be doing and is going to be doing all within its capabilities and possibilities to ensure that we can look forward to banning the process. I am pleased to see that the Parliament has given this opportunity today to debate, Presiding Officer, because it is vitally important that we send a very strong message from this chamber to these individuals and organisations that we will not accept what has been the practice in the past. And we want to ensure that there's a constructive debate here on this whole topic. Therefore, it's really good to see that there has been cross-party sense consensus on this issue about banning this abhorrent practice. And it's vitally important that the ban is effective, that the ban is comprehensive, and the ban is timorous in what it's trying to achieve. So in concluding, Presiding Officer, going forward, myself and the other members of the committee stand ready to scrutinise the government's progress on this issue and ensure that any forthcoming ban meets every one of the criteria that we've set out, because that is what we said to these individuals who gave us evidence, that we would take on board their views, their opinions, and we would protect individuals for the future. And by having a ban, that will certainly be the case. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Stewart. And I call on Pam Duncan-Glancy for around 5 minutes. Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. After many months of committee work on this issue and on developing the report before Parliament, I'm pleased to lead this debate for Scottish Labour today. I want to start by paying tribute to the hard work of Blair Anderson and Tristan Gray, who brought the petition on conversion practice to this Parliament, and who both spoke powerfully when in front of the committee on the need for a full and comprehensive ban on conversion practices. Their motivation, persistence and dedication to ending these hateful practices in Scotland are the reason we are here today discussing the report, and I hope we will be discussing real legislative changes in the not too distant future. I want to share my deepest thank you with Blair and other survivors of conversion practice whose bravery in sharing their stories with the Equalities and Human Rights Committee reinforced to us the horror of what can and is happening in the absence of legislation. When we talk about conversion practice, we may think of it happening in faraway countries, in places we associate with being regressive in their equalities and human rights laws, in cults perhaps, or vehemently hardline religious settings. That's why hearing from our survivors has been so important, because the reality is that it is happening here in Scotland. The reality of where it takes place and how it manifests is far more complex. Blair Anderson's experience, for example, happened at the hands of his parents in his own family home. Another testimony I heard spoke of conversion practice that took place over several years in an evangelical setting and by people the survivor themselves described as people with some of the biggest hearts I've ever encountered. These things are happening in small places close to home, which, as Eleanor Roosevelt reminds us, is exactly where our human rights begin. Presiding Officer, this is about human rights. This is why it matters, and this is why it is incumbent upon us to act. And for people out there today who are living through this trauma, things are moving slowly and not at the pace required to prevent what is effectively a process of torture We cannot tolerate this. The committee has heard a wealth of evidence on the practices that continue to take place in Scotland, and as a country who prides itself on its progressive values, we would fail in our duty to act if we held off any longer, and I'm pleased to hear the commitment from the Minister that we'll move apace today. The Scottish Government have previously argued that it must wait and see what the UK Government legislation due to come forward in this area may look like before moving to introduce its own legislation. On that matter, the evidence I have seen from the UK Government so far really worries me. The Prime Minister himself has spoken of gay conversion therapy, suggesting that it will come not as a ban would come, but not as a full and comprehensive ban that we need. I'm clear that any legislation must include all non-affirmative forms of therapy for trans people too. We heard in our sessions that trans people are likely those within the LGBT plus community who are at most risk from these practices, and so it is crucial that a ban ensures they are protected and applied to both sexual orientation and gender identity. If we look to international best practice, the Conversion Practices Prohibition Act 2021 from Victoria, Australia, sets out a criterion of three pillars to define conversion therapy: that the conduct is directly targeted, that it has taken place on the basis of someone's sexual orientation or of their gender identity, and that the conduct has a predetermined outcome to change a person's behaviour. My vision of a full and comprehensive ban, informed by much of the evidence heard by our committee, would have to go at least as far as this to be a worthy piece of legislation that ensures abhorrent conversion practices that fulfil this criteria are prohibited and criminalised. I'm also clear that a ban of this framework must protect affirmative approaches too and alleviate concerns that medical or religious professionals could be punished for offering therapy like that. The committee heard that affirmative therapy is about holding the space for an individual to find out who they are and ensuring they can come to that decision themselves in a supportive way. This, I believe, is crucial because it outlines the clear difference between these vital supportive conversions that are conversations that allow people to grow and develop themselves and the practices which we would be seeking to ban, practices that force someone down a particular route. For this legislation to deliver on its aims, there must be no room for loopholes or exemptions. It must be comprehensive and watertight. Again, the UK Government legislation is likely to fall short in that. So far, there's been a worrying indication that it believes consent to conversion practice is possible. Allowing manoeuvre or interpretation in this area would allow for consent to be used as a defence, and survivors have been clear. Consent is a misnomer, a red herring, a completely misleading use of terminology. As Blair Anderson so strongly put it, people cannot consent to being tortured or abused. We've closed these loopholes in legislation before if we look to the law banning female genital mutilation, as well as forced marriage. We can and must do it again. And we must ensure that in this case, as we move forward with what I hope will be a concrete piece of legislation in the coming period, we must do the same here. Deputy Presiding Officer, we have no time to lose on this, and I urge colleagues across the Chamber to act with impatience and to act here, in this place, to end conversion practices as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Duncan Glassie, and I call Willie Rennie for around 4 minutes, Mr Rennie.
The committee, I think, have done some excellent work. I mean, I thought Joe Fitzpatrick delivered his contribution with passion and care. I think the report is good, and I think it's sensitive, and I think it's thorough. And I think this whole chamber should be grateful, because I think this is a committee doing its work at its best. A UK survey of 108,000 LGBT plus people in the UK showed that nearly 1 in 13 have been offered or have been compelled to receive conversion therapy or practice. Therapy in their mind, practice in ours. That number rose to 1 in 7. Amongst transgender people. I think the word therapy, and I agree with Joe Fitzpatrick on this, is incredibly misleading and extremely inaccurate. These practices are not a benefit, so are not a therapy. Author and sociologist Deshaun Stokes said, it's not conversion therapy, it's conversion brainwashing, and we should say what we mean. Some of those who facilitate this practice do so out of a misguided idea that they are somehow helping. But the evidence is to the contrary, and it's abundantly clear. Those who have suffered through it have spoken of the negative effects on their lives and the trauma that it has left them with. The mental health charity Mind has said that this practice can cause a great deal of psychological distress. It often leads to long-term feelings of isolation and low self-esteem. As a result, far too many people are left to struggle with anxiety and depression, which in some cases results in self-harm and even suicide. People coming to this therapy are often at a vulnerable point in their lives. Just when they are in most need of a space to share their thoughts and feelings openly and freely, they are being met with judgment and ignorance. People are being let down. The situation, as Pam Duncan-Glancy said, is urgent. Any practice which seeks to suppress or change a person's sexual orientation or gender identity is a harmful practice. And it is quite baffling why it's still happening in Scotland. I therefore support the committee on the adoption of the UN definition. My party has a proud tradition of fostering diversity and championing the rights of individuals to privacy and autonomy. We believe that people should be able to live their lives as they see fit, unencumbered and without intrusion. These principles are crucial to the protection of LGBT plus orientations and identities. That's why we believe these practices should be entirely banned. As the committee has shown in its report, 6 countries, including 20 United States states, have already enforced a ban. So what are we waiting for? And I was pleased with the Minister's response and the constructive engagement between the Minister and the committee. That bodes well for getting this right. And I don't think we should wait on UK legislation. We've done it before. We should just crack on with it. We should be bringing that forward, that legislation now, to rid ourselves of this practice. I want to leave you with the words of Carlin. Carlin is a trans woman in her 70s who has written of the impact of the practice still has on her lives years later. Whenever I remembered the treatment I'd had, I would start physically shaking. In that sense, you could say the therapy worked, in that it affected my body. But in terms of my mind and my thoughts, it only made me hate myself more. It was only when I retired, aged 55, that I felt I could live openly as myself. And while things got so much better, I'd still have flashbacks from my conversion therapy sessions 40 years later. For Carlin and so many others, let's just get this done.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call first Fulton MacGregor, then to be followed by Megan Gallagher for around 4 minutes, Mr. MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's a great pleasure to speak in this debate today in what seems so far anyway a very consensual debate across the chamber. And as a member of the Equalities Committee, I want to associate myself with the words of the convener at the start. There should be little argument about whether conversion practices should end in Scotland. These practices are abhorrent. They cause undue harm and trauma and have absolutely no place in today's Scotland. I also want to welcome the commitment of the Scottish Government, as put forward by the Minister, to bring forward legislation to ban conversion practices by 2023. And I do believe that the UK Government proposals do not go far enough to protect people in Scotland, and we need to do what we can here in this chamber. As a committee, we have heard extensive and often emotional and harrowing testimonies from those who have survived conversion practices in one form or another, and others have already spoke eloquently about some of these testimonies. And I, like them, want to put on record my thanks to these individuals, because I know that it couldn't have been easy for them, and I hope what they told us will now go on to shape legislation and protect others. And I would also encourage the Government, as others have done, and ultimately, I guess, the advisory group, not to duplicate the work that we've done, because we don't want people to have to share their stories again and potentially relive that trauma again. I think that that's an issue the Minister has already acknowledged. And I do think it's also important, as the committee has done, for the advisory group to take into account international examples of best practice, such as Victoria in Australia, as Pam Duncan-Glancy has mentioned. And we can learn from these jurisdictions, because there was issues we heard there that perhaps they could have done things differently as well, and they're now looking to change that. So if there is best examples out there in international practice, we can look to them. But unfortunately, the truth is, Presiding Officer, that these practices still very much exist in Scotland. The UK Government's National LGBT Survey 2018 has found that 5% of LGBTQ plus people have been offered but did not proceed with conversion therapy. A further 2% of people had undergone conversion therapy. The Scottish Government, as we know, is committed to ensuring that everyone, regardless of their sexual orientation or gender identity, is safe from such horrendous conversion practices in Scotland. There is absolutely no credible evidence, as the Minister has said, that these practices even work. Indeed, I don't even believe it's about whether they work or not. I believe that the notion that you can change someone's sexual orientation or gender identity is simply wrong at its core. The practices which encourage suppression and denial are also wrong, and ultimately cause an individual great harm, as we've heard, and impact their mental health in a multitude of ways. Being LGBTI is not a choice, and we cannot treat it as such. I'm also pleased that our report from the committee took the view that the definition of conversion practices in any proposed law should make it clear there is no such thing as informed consent to the practice and that it cannot be used as a defence by those carrying it out. And I think Pam Duncan-Glancy was the one that quoted one of her witnesses to the committee when they said you can't consent to torture. And there is evidence that those who are said to consent are actually coerced and do so under significant pressure from others. It feels important also to highlight that most faith leaders, because I think this is the area of most discussion, if you like, do support a ban on conversion practices. And we know that legislation should not restrict ordinary religious teaching or the right of people to take part in any prayer or pastoral care to discuss, explore or come to terms with their identity in a non-judgmental and non-directive way. In fact, the committee did hear evidence that for many survivors of conversion practices, their faith was a big part of their identity and is a big part of their identity, and they have often at times felt forced to choose between faith and their sexual orientation or gender identity, and this is clearly wrong and should not happen. And in fact, some of the faith leaders who had concerns about a ban on conversion therapy did actually share their views that they thought that the practice itself was abhorrent, but it was about the technicalities of how it might be banned.
I'm afraid you need to conclude now, Mr McGregor.
Okay, thanks, President Officer. It's been a short debate in terms of speaking. There is more I could have said, but I do welcome the committee's report and I welcome the government's response to that. And I look forward to a day when this important practice is banned. Thank you, President
Officer. Thank you. Megan Gallagher now, to be followed by Karen Adam again. Strict 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we've already heard from voices across the chamber today, there is a consensus amongst MSPs to ban conversion practices here in Scotland. Should the ban on conversion therapy be voted through, Scotland would follow 13 other countries worldwide that have already banned this practice, including Brazil, Norway, Switzerland and several regions of Spain. I share the views of many MSPs in this Parliament that conversion therapy, or as it's sometimes referred to as gay cure therapy, is wrong and it has no place in modern-day society. It is therefore upsetting to learn, and as highlighted by Fulton McGregor, that as recently as 2018, a study conducted by National LGBT found that around 5% of LGBT respondents said that they had been offered conversion therapy to cure them of being LGBT. Being gay, lesbian or bisexual is not an illness. People within the LGBT community have nothing to be ashamed of. In fact, they should be able to love who they want and be comfortable in their own skin. In preparation for today's debate, I read statements of conversion therapy survivors such as Justin Beck, who realised that he was attracted to men and turned to his place of worship for guidance. He put himself forward for conversion therapy and was left completely emotionally traumatised by the experience, which he described as enforced repression. Justin, of course, is one of many examples of individuals who have been subjected to conversion therapy. We must continue to listen to those who have endured such practices to ensure that this Parliament finally implements the ban. The persecution of LGBT people has a horrific and dark history, and we must continue to look at and debate ways to help and support those who are members of this community. One way to do this would be to consign conversion therapy to the history books during this parliamentary term. In October 2021, the UK Government announced that it would consult on the proposals to implement a legislative ban on conversion therapy across England and Wales. The bill itself would criminalise the talking conversion therapy, which would prevent any non-consensual attempt to convince or coerce a gay person to be straight or vice versa. It is my understanding that the Scottish Government has taken a different approach and, as is its right, is a devolved administration, in terms of its implementation to ban conversion therapy, and ongoing discussions have taken place between the UK and Scottish Governments to ensure consistency when looking at this important issue. It is also welcome, after hearing robust evidence from the Equalities Committee during the last parliamentary term, that an advisory group has been set up to investigate how to implement the ban here in Scotland. And I also recognise the Minister's comments around religious freedoms and the concerns religious groups have raised. It is a delicate situation, and I hope the advisory group will continue to look at and engage with all views on conversion therapy as we move forward. As my colleague Alexander Stewart rightly highlighted during his contribution, it now falls on the Scottish Government to ensure progress is made to prevent yet more LGBT people facing the humiliating and mentally traumatising practice of conversion therapy. However, as the group will not meet until the end of the month, I think we still need reassurance, and the Minister has given some of that already, that this matter will be treated with urgency and the care and respect that it deserves, especially as this issue was first raised with the Scottish Parliament in 2020 through a petition that secured over 5,000 signatures. Presiding Officer, we're now 2 years down the road. Survivors and campaigners will be eager to see this ban in place as soon as possible. There is overwhelming support across this Parliament and indeed throughout our communities to end conversion therapy practices. I therefore, to conclude, join calls from across the Chamber to bring this bill forward as quickly as possible and to ban conversion therapy here in Scotland. Thank you.
You very much, Ms Gallagher. I now call on Karen Adam to be followed by Paula Kane for 4 minutes, please, Ms Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This report and the work of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee over the last few months is something that I certainly shall never forget, not least because it was my first substantial piece of work as an MSP and as a committee member, but because this is a vital piece of work in progressing towards a more inclusive society. But most importantly, Presiding Officer, because of the evidence that I heard during our sessions, I want to thank everybody who came and gave evidence to the committee, most of all those who shared their lived experience. And particular mention to the End Conversion Therapy Scotland campaign, who have tirelessly worked hard to ensure this harmful practice comes to an end here in Scotland. I know that there are some out there who believe that LGBT conversion practices will rectify sexual or gender identity, but to rectify something insinuates that something needs fixed. Generations of LGBT people have been made to feel less than or that there's something fundamentally wrong with who they are simply for being same-sex attracted or discovering that their gender identity doesn't correspond with the assumed gender they were assigned at birth. The only thing wrong in that regard is how societies across the world have inflicted harm on LGBT people simply for existing. To get an idea of how unreasonable conversion practices are, can you imagine a world where cisgendered straight people were made to undergo methods to change their sexual orientation and gender identity, being instructed to alter their heterosexual or cisgendered lifestyle? The psychological torture of lesbian women, gay men, bisexual and trans people cannot continue. So just as straight cisgendered people are left to live out their lives in peace with their sexual orientation and gender identity never been brought into question, it's time to leave LGBT people in peace too, without intervention. Not only must conversion practices come to an end in Scotland, but all of us in this chamber today, as role models, public figures and lawmakers, have a responsibility to embody that change in our day-to-day lives, calling out bigotry where we see it, offering to support to those in need of it, and stand shoulder to shoulder against all forms of abuse. I remember as part of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee's evidence session on conversion practices, I heard from two people in a closed meeting. After one session in particular, I broke down. I was in my office with my face in my hands. It was extremely hard to hear of the practical methods of torture in reality and the psychological harm that we as a society have inflicted on so many. The torment endured by the individual I had just spoken with was cruel and torturous. I could not stop thinking the entire time of how unnecessary their experience had been for this woman simply because she was trans. What she needed more than anything was love, support and acceptance. Instead, what she endured was torment and abuse in the form of gaslighting. The stigma and outdated pressures which force this situation into being is thankfully now not seen as acceptable, many in society now support a ban. And as my colleagues have said today, many in the medical and psychological professionals and regulatory bodies, such as the British Medical Association, and most faith leaders support a ban too. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I am delighted that the hard-working campaigners have been heard, that the voices of those with lived experience has been listened to. And I'm delighted to see this work the government is doing to progress a ban on these practices. But we must take this as one part of many to eradicate any notion that being LGBTQIA+ is anything but okay. We must move to acknowledge that cisgendered and heterosexual is not the default setting for a human being. And not only should we not discriminate against someone based on their sexuality or gender identity, but we should actively welcome and embrace all into our culture here in Scotland, the many varied and wonderful people our country is made up of. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by John Mason. 4 minutes, please, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to be able to contribute to this extremely important committee debate and to follow powerful speeches by colleagues across the Chamber. And may I also pay tribute to the work of colleagues in the Equalities, Human Rights and Social Justice Committee for their work thus far in investigating and reporting on conversion practices and for the recommendation contained in the report for a comprehensive legal ban. As a substitute member of the committee, I have had little insight into the testimony offered by witnesses and the power contained therein, particularly from those who have suffered the pain of so-called conversion therapy. I think it is also right that we pay tribute to the petitioners, End Conversion Therapy Scotland, and the many organisations who have supported it and indeed have supported the committee's work. Presiding Officer, conversion practices are dangerous, cruel, and cause lasting damage to those who experience them. They are in violation of fundamental human rights. And in the words of Amnesty International, they are inherently humiliating, demeaning and discriminatory. Evidence shows that the majority of conversion practices are carried out in a faith setting. As a person of faith, I find that horrifying. And as a gay person, I have found that terrifying. I am fortunate that I have never had to experience what survivors bravely spoke about to the committee. As a survivor from Glasgow described, I'm not sure I could ever put into enough words the effect it has had on my life. I mean, it has nearly cost me my life on several occasions because I could not cope with who I was, who I am. I feel robbed of joy, of safety, of self-worth, of opportunity, of who I actually am and who I should have been free to explore and live all my life. So much of what I went on to experience and how I've struggled to navigate through my life has stemmed from this. That is hard to contemplate. Joy, safety, self-worth, fundamentals for our very existence. And whilst I have never experienced conversion practices directly, as a Christian, I have had some encounters that I believe can ultimately lead to them being employed. Being told that being LGBT+ is sinful, a sinful choice, and that conversion is required. Being told there is something intrinsically disordered about LGBT+ people, being held to different standards to heterosexual peers, even having someone at church write to my dad when I was young to out me on the expectation that he would do something about the incompatibility of my faith and my sexuality. I was lucky. In response, my family have only ever shown me love and affirmation. But not everyone is so fortunate. As we have heard already, 7% of LGBT+ people in Scotland have either undergone or been offered so-called conversion therapy, including 10% of trans people. And we know from evidence that this is often part of family pressure. I was particularly pleased to be in committee on the day Jane Ozan of the Ozan Foundation gave very compelling evidence in this regard. And I've been heartened to see the committee finding that the majority of religious organisations are opposed to conversion therapy and support a ban. And I want to particularly praise on an international level the work of Father James Martin, SJ, and Dr Mary McAleese, the former President of the Republic of Ireland, for their work that has had a profound impact on me and on my faith. Presiding Officer, today is another step towards ending conversion practices in Scotland, but we now need a bill for a comprehensive ban. And I do know what the Minister has said in regards to that, and I would associate myself with the comments of colleagues on the need for urgency. But we know that legislation alone is not enough. We do need resources, support services for victims and survivors, and a comprehensive awareness campaign on the unacceptability of conversion practice. But for now, to LGBT plus people of all faiths and none, I will finish with a quote. I am fearfully and wonderfully made, and so are you. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. McCain. I now call on John Mason to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity to speak, and I welcome the committee report, and I'm happy to support a ban as well. And I think we should start with what we are all agreed on, and I hope we would all be against any attempts to force people to change what they are, and also against any use of beating or other types of violence. Where there is likely to be some disagreement is over definitions and terms being used. For example, conversion is seen in many religious circles as being a positive word. It means turning around and is good if somebody is turning away from something bad, like alcohol or drug abuse. One of the best known conversions was of St. Paul, who turned from persecuting Christian believers to becoming one himself. So most people would see that as positive. I think we also need to draw a distinction between sexual orientation and sexual activity. The main thrust of Bible teaching is on activity. For example, sexual relationships should be within marriage, although there is also teaching against attitudes like lust. So whereas society as a whole and our legal setup would allow multiple sexual relationships, Christian teaching would encourage sexual relations with just one person, and that within marriage. And presumably we can accept that a religion or a club or an association should be free to have its own teaching going above and beyond the law of the land, whether that be a dress code in a bowling club or nightclub, or teaching around alcohol or sex in a religious setting. So if a Christian leader engages in sexual relationship outside marriage, as I know has happened recently with a prominent church leader in Canada, that person would be expected to stand down and to repent of their wrong actions. This is despite no Canadian law having been broken. As convener of the Cross-Party Group on Freedom of Religion or Belief, I would want to urge Parliament to be careful about interfering too much with religious beliefs and practices. This certainly applies to the practice of prayer, which is primarily about a person's relationship with God. Now, I accept, and Jesus himself taught, that prayer can be abused and end up being more about speaking to people rather than to God. However, at its heart, prayer is about a very intimate relationship, including bringing problems to him and asking for his wisdom in how to deal with these problems. Only God knows our hearts, our true intentions, and our deepest thoughts. So I think the state has to be wary of interfering in someone's relationship with God through prayer, whether that be an individual praying, or two people praying together, or prayer in a group setting. Another aspect of this is self-control. Especially in the New Testament, there are 9 great values called the fruits of the Holy Spirit, and these include love, joy, peace, etc. One of these is self-control. Therefore, Christian teaching and prayer would not be so much on a right or wrong sexual orientation, if that is what someone is. To a large extent, that needs to be accepted. However, the need for self-control and choosing not to put your thoughts or desires into action is key. I might have a natural desire to eat the attractive food I see. Many of us are tempted to eat too much chocolate or drink too much alcohol. So that is where self-control comes in. We sometimes need to say no to ourselves. Following on from that, any repentance and prayer would be focused on wrong activities rather than wrong orientation. It was wrong to drink so much alcohol. How can I change? It was wrong for me to have sex with various people. How can I change? So broadly speaking, I'm happy to support a ban on conversion practices, but with the condition that we are careful about definitions in the legislation and we do not attempt to interfere in freedom of religion or belief. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mason. I now call on Gillian Mackay, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Emma Roddick. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thanks also to the Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee for their work gathering evidence and compiling this report into ending conversion practices in Scotland. Thanks to campaigners, witnesses who gave evidence, and all those who have written to their MSPs expressing support for decisive action. It can be all too easy when we see significant moments of progress for LGBTQ plus people, such as repealing Section 28 or bringing in marriage equality, that we think the job is done and the fight for equality is won. It can be easy to forget all those who are left behind who are forgotten in those moments, all of those whose stories we never get to hear. By definition, conversion therapy is silencing. It tells LGBTQ plus people that who they truly are needs shut up and hidden away, that they're broken and need fixed, that they're sick and need cured, that they are wrong and need converted. I hope that today we can all say with one voice, without reservation or hesitation, all of Scotland's LGBTQ plus people, and especially to those who are not yet able to say it aloud for themselves, you are not broken. You are not sick. You are not wrong. You do not need fixed or cured or converted, because who you are is perfect. We will protect you from those who would try and change you. While we have seen progress on LGBTQ plus equality in Scotland throughout the lifetime of this Parliament, we've also seen in recent years a deeply concerning rise in transphobia in Scottish public life, and especially online. At the heart of homophobia, biphobia and transphobia is hatred and fear of those who are different, of those whose sexual and gender diversity goes against what has often been considered the norm. Conversion therapy puts that hatred and fear into practice. Conversion therapy tells people, often forces people, to shut up, deny themselves and go back in the closet. One of the most common concerns I've seen in public debate in recent months is about the impact of a conversion therapy ban on trans people, and especially young trans people. Some people seem concerned that a conversion therapy ban will criminalise parents trying to support children who are struggling with their own sexuality or gender identity, that we will be complicit in forcing confused young people to be trans. This is not true. The idea that there is a big conspiracy or agenda to turn young people trans is a lie designed to scaremonger. It's one that we've heard before against cis, lesbians, gay and bi people in the debates around Section 28 and equal marriage. It's designed to stir up fear and anxiety about those who are different. What was true then is still true now. LGBTQ plus people are not trying to turn your children gay or trans. They're trying to build a world where gay and trans children are safe, loved and accepted. I'm grateful to the committee for spelling out so clearly in their report the reality of affirming care and what it means for young people. It does not mean anyone will try to turn someone into something they're not. It does mean that people struggling with their sexuality or gender identity will be given safe and accepting space in which to come to terms with who they truly are without prejudice or pressure. I hope that one day soon we will not just be debating conversion practices, but we will be passing legislation that ends it for good. Scotland's young people deserve a country where they can grow up to be truly who they are, and that requires a conversion therapy ban that protects all of Scotland's LGBTQ plus people. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay. I now call on Emma Roddick, to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the first out parliamentarian to represent the Highlands and Islands, this issue is one very close to my heart and it strikes very close to home. I know that also representing part of the region, you also understand how important greater acceptance of LGBTQI neighbours, particularly in our rural and island communities, is. The implication of conversion therapy that my sexuality and the sexualities and gender identities of many of my friends and others in the community is wrong or something that should or could be fixed is offensive to me. As my colleague Mr Fitzpatrick outlined in his opening remarks, therapy is an inaccurate way of describing conversion practices. A member of my team told me today that the word therapy derives from the Greek word for healing. Conversion practices are just the opposite. They inflict severe pain and suffering, resulting in long-lasting psychological and physical damage. As someone with mental health issues brought on by trauma, it is disgusting to me that this is something anyone would wish to debate. Anyone who feels there is any defence to openly stating that anyone else should be legally free to cause harm, and we know that conversion practices do cause real harm to someone else because of something they can't choose or control, should be deeply ashamed of themselves. I also want to echo an important point others have already made, that many people of faith firmly believe in ending conversion practices and supporting LGBTQI people. Like many here, I've also been contacted by some who are concerned that an end to conversion practices infringes on their right to religion. Now, I respect people's rights to have a religion and to hold personal beliefs, and I respect that often religion influences those beliefs. I know myself that attending Scripture Union and being a part of a religious community had a huge impact on my development of a moral compass and of my world views. What I do not respect are views which I do not consider deserving of respect, namely views that I or people like me are not worthy of respect ourselves because of who we are, or that we shouldn't have a right to bodily autonomy, or that our human right not to be subjected to torture or degrading treatment should not be upheld. I do not respect hate, and I do not respect the use of religion as a shield for bigotry. When I was taught Christianity by some of the kindest people I have ever known, I was taught to accept and forgive, and that it was not for me to pass judgment on others. This is not a matter of freedom of religion. Homophobia is not a religion. Transphobia is not a religion. The violence of psychologically tormenting LGBTQ people is not a protected belief. The right to hate others has nothing to do with the Christianity that I know. On the matter of self-control, self-control is only an admirable virtue when the thing that you're trying to control is inherently wrong. Being a queer person is not wrong, it's beautiful, and no queer person should be told to control themselves. I'd suggest that those who feel the need to try and control and change others to the point that they want to intervene on their human rights should show some self-control and consider whether it is their place to judge, or their place to decide that someone else's behaviour or sexual orientation is something to be fixed. People are gay, people are trans, get over it. I would like to finish by directly addressing my colleagues on the Scottish National Party benches and to all those who share my aim to create a better Scotland. We are rightly proud of Scotland's historic record on LGBTQI rights. It's the sort of basis for the Scotland of the future that makes me so hopeful about the future of our country. We cannot allow ourselves to slip, to slow down in our determination to make this country the best it can be. We must follow the example of France and Canada and ban conversion practices in Scotland for good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Rorick. Can I call final speaker in the open debate, Craig Coy, for up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Rorick.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank the Equalities Committee for their report and the Minister for the commitment she has given today. And at the outset, as a gay man, let me say this. The process of coming out and coming to terms with sexuality is not simple. Different people take very different routes on the same journey. For some, coming to terms with being gay today will be a straightforward step. But for others, the path they take will be far more difficult to travel. Many will engage the support of family or friends, and some might seek counselling. But this should never involve counselling to find a cure. And it should never, ever involve coercion, for there is no illness to treat and no abnormality to be normalised. Trying to argue against people being gay in Scotland today is like arguing against the Scottish weather. The young gay men and women who walk past this Parliament every day and who walk into this Parliament every day are as much a part of the natural fabric of Scotland as the drizzle that too frequently falls upon them. Deputy Presiding Officer, trying to influence the weather would prove futile and ineffective, and so too is seeking to influence people's sexuality, even though in the past the state, the law, religion and sometimes the medical profession have tried to do so. Since then, however, thankfully, society has changed, but the views of some have not. People have a right to believe in different things. We cannot and we should not legislate against this. But we do need to legislate to give people protection from the consequences of this. And that is what we are debating today. Conversion therapy or conversion practices are dangerous, especially, but not only, where coercion is involved. It can damage people's mental health and scar people's lives irreparably, as Willie Rennie has said. It relies on discredited practices practices which have been rejected by medical and mental health professionals for decades. But sadly, this practice is not uncommon. As we have heard in 2017, the National LGBT Survey found that 5% of respondents said they had been offered conversion or reparative therapy. A further 2% had undergone that therapy. I believe that a ban on conversion therapy is now overdue, and I welcome the Minister's commitment and hope that the Government will move swiftly. For any individual or organisation to try to change or suppress someone's sexuality is fundamentally wrong, but not all agree. And I looked closely at the words of the Christian Institute. They warned that laws on conversion therapy could put prayer, preaching, parenting and pastoral care at risk. And I will look with interest to see how their opposition will be sustained, particularly as I hope that the legislation carefully addresses and protects religious freedoms. Deputy Presiding Officer, I welcome the committee's report and I understand the need for urgency, but I do hope that the safeguards we put in place can be broadly aligned across the UK. And that is why I hope that this Parliament looks closely at the recommendations and the laws that come forward from the UK Government and that apply in England and Wales. And if we then determine that that legislation does not go far enough, then we in this Parliament can, of course, legislate in that regards. Deputy Presiding Officer, it was the words of conversion practice survivors which influenced the committee's report. And I thank those brave individuals and those groups for opening up and sharing their stories. Today, the advertisements we see on the television feature lesbian and gay couples. Being gay no longer requires you to tell lies, to feel guilty, or to feel abnormal. Nobody should feel the need to change who they are, and nobody should pressurise them into doing so. And that is why I look forward to the UK joining other progressive nations in bringing forward a comprehensive ban on these practices. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Hoy. We now move to closing speeches. I call Pam Duncan-Glancy for up to 5 minutes, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Oh, sorry. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the debate that's taking place in the Chamber today, and I'm pleased to see the cross-party support for pace on legislation and the need for a comprehensive ban on conversion practice. I particularly welcome the Minister's commitment to end the practices soon. I'd also like to thank my colleagues on the committee for the passion and fervour that they have approached this. I'm proud to associate myself with their words today. I'd like to thank Joe Fitzpatrick in particular for steering us through this work and specifically for setting out the importance of the difference between therapy and practice, and to agree with him and Willie Rennie and Emma Roddick and others that these practices are of no benefit, therefore are not therapy. I strongly welcome Gillian Mackay's words that LGBT people are not wrong and do not need converted, and the member's clarification on what the ban does and does not do in relation to trans people. I also thank, therefore, the convener for setting out the committee's strong support for the comprehensive ban. I note some of the comments made in the chamber, acknowledging the concerns raised by some religious organisations around potential conflict. I want to address some of these concerns and state clearly that undermining religious relationships and support is not at all what legislation seeks to do. Indeed, many people spoke to the committee of the need to ensure that they can live how they are and embrace their faith. Instead, this legislation would seek to create the best environment for religion to remain a positive influence in people's lives. While much evidence of conversion practice has shown that it often takes place in religious settings, it cannot be ignored that religion remains a strong factor in the lives of many people, and that for those whose sexual orientation or gender identity doesn't marry up with the religious views of themselves or those around them, it is an incredibly difficult situation to feel that there is a need to choose between those two things. Indeed, my colleague Paul O'Kane has said that it is horrifying to have to make that choice, which is exactly why we must protect belief by supporting people to continue to express it, but also protecting LGBT people's rights to be able to be who they are. I thank my colleagues on the committee again, including the chair of the committee, for setting out that the committee share this view today. I speak in this chamber often about my commitment to human rights, a commitment which I believe should be shared by all of us, and I know is shared by many of my colleagues across these benches. And I want to offer reassurance that human rights, including the protection from torture and abuse, which legislation could seek to protect, do not and should not contradict each other. And in this case, I am equally as committed to protecting Article 19 of the Human Rights Act and the protection of freedom, thought and religion. I think it is poignant to note that far too often in recent times, human rights of different groups have been weaponised and held up as direct contradictions to one another. But that is not how human rights work. They are indivisible and interdependent and interrelated, and only where they are treated as such can they be truly enjoyed. I want to recognise the Scottish Government's intentions and place on record that I welcome the Minister's commitment to progress a ban as soon as possible and to follow, as Megan Gallagher says, many other countries in doing so. I also welcome the Minister's commitment to use the committee evidence as a cornerstone of the Government's approach. The evidence our committee heard and the report is produced is comprehensive and detailed. Further probing for more evidence, particularly for those with lived experience, could re-traumatise people. And my colleague Karen Adam has spoke passionately about the impact that evidence had on us as third parties listening to it. Imagine how hard it is to live it and relive it. So I, as Fulton MacGregor and Alexander Stewart have also said, understand the need to work with the expert group to refine the legislation, but urge that it does not duplicate or delay work. I will close by suggesting gently to my colleague Craig Hoy that we don't wait to see if the UK Government's legislation goes far enough, and by quoting Vic Valentine from the Scottish Trans Alliance, who told the committee that we have the powers to act now without waiting for the UK Government to act. He said specifically, the bulk of the legislative aspect is about the criminal ban, and that would be fully devolved to the Scottish Parliament. Deputy Presiding Officer, this Parliament has been bold and progressive before. In fact, we are doing exactly that with other progressive legislation right now. We can, and I believe will, be bold again. So let's not wait any longer. All five Holyrood parties committed to a ban on conversion practice in their manifestos, and that commitment has been reiterated in the Chamber today. The will is here, the motivation is here. Now let's have the legislation and consign conversion practice to the history books once and for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Duncan Glancy. And I call on Pam Gosal for up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Gosal.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful to be closing this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. As a member of the Equalities and Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, I would like to begin by expressing my gratitude alongside my colleagues from the committee to the witnesses for sharing their traumatic experiences of conversion practices. The member, Pam Duncan Glancy, talked about the bravery of some of the survivors, which I want to echo. Your bravery will go a long way in preventing, protecting and supporting individuals who would potentially be, are or have been subject to conversion practices. We heard from the member Karen Adams and Willie Rennie how these practices can cause great psychological stress and long-time harm and are cruel and torturous. The member Paul O'Kane also said conversion practices are dangerous and cruel and leave long-lasting damage. The witness testimonies we heard were heart-wrenching and in some cases horrifying. One witness said it can totally strip away all the good bits of you and leave you de-oscillate and completely isolated. When the witness was in the darkest moments, he went to the fourth bridge twice and looked over the edge. The Scottish Conservatives believe conversion practices are shocking and unacceptable, and we therefore wholeheartedly support an effective comprehensive ban on conversion practices. This was also highlighted by the members Fulton MacGregor and Joe Fitzpatrick today. Conversion practice should not be acceptable in Scotland and should be banned. They have no place in Scotland. I appreciate that creating robust legislation can be time-consuming. However, as we heard from my colleague Alexander Stewart, the ban itself and subsequent criminalisation is a devolved matter, and so I would like to see more timely progress made on the legislation by the Scottish Government. It was welcoming to hear from the Minister that they will work with the committee through the expert group and agrees it is essential to act now, as these practices are harmful. Throughout the consultation, I wanted to grasp how conversion practices affected minority groups. The consensus is that the conversion therapy presents itself in many different settings and manifests itself differently depending on factors such as background, ethnicity and religion. As such, we established a deep need to connect with those often unreachable by mainstream services. Third sector organisations such as HIDE, which are practically tailored to these in honour-based cultures and will be key to reaching supporting individuals. In many cases, the committee heard victims were LGBT individuals of faith, which is why striking a balance between freedom of religion and banning conversion practices is so important. Many individuals seek comfort, understanding and hope from religious settings, and we do not seek to discourage neither pastors nor individuals from this relationship. So we welcome commitments by the Scottish Government to work alongside religious and community leaders to ensure religious settings still feel confident in their ability to provide care for LGBT individuals of faith, while ensuring the law is robust enough to prevent conversion practices. The member John Mason spoke about the state needing to be very wary that if people are just going there to pray. Many members, like Emma Ruddock, Gillian Mackay, talked about the importance of the right definition and that theory is not maybe the right definition to be used. Despite legislation being in place to prevent domestic abuse, it still happens. Despite legislation being in place to stop FGM, it still happens. We know that in many cases, conversion practices take place underground or behind closed doors. So for any forthcoming ban to be truly effective in stamping out conversion therapy, there must be an effective whistleblowing mechanisms and oversight in place that these can be implemented prior to any legislation. I have asked during the committee proceedings who should be responsible for such oversight, whether this should be a public body or a third sector organisation. And I would ask the Scottish Government to consider that at this stage. Presiding Officer, we have heard many thoughtful contributions today across the Chamber. My colleague Crehoy raised the importance of working cooperatively across the UK to ensure consistency and safeguards against conversion practices. And my colleague Megan Gallagher rightly states we have the opportunity now to consign conversion practices to the history books. In my concluding remarks, Presiding Officer, I round off by repeating. Firstly, the Scottish Conservatives fully support a ban on conversion practices and are committed to working cross-party to ensure that the legislation is effective and works for everyone, especially those who have been let down. Secondly, while legislation is being developed, other mechanisms such as support services, third sector organisations and mainstream services can be actioned. And last but not least, Presiding Officer, education and awareness are key to the effectiveness of legislation, and any information campaign should be targeted and detailed.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Gosnell. I now call on the Minister for up to 7 minutes, Ms McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you so much to everyone for their thought-provoking and detailed contributions today. I want to, along with many of the members, Karen Adam, Alexander Stewart, Pam Duncan Clancy, Pam Gosnell, Megan Gallagher, Willie Rennie and Fulton McGregor, no doubt others, to thank the people who gave their testimony to the committee work. I think we could never express our gratitude enough for people who have been through such a horrendous situation to bring that to us, to help inform us in the work that we have to do and to help us move forward with that, but always being mindful of the impact that it has on those individuals as well. Can I make a couple of points on religious freedom? I'm absolutely clear that we know there's concerns around the potential impacts on religious freedoms, and these will be considered very carefully as we go along. And any support or understanding or ideas that come from across the chamber, my door and my ears are wide open to hear all of that. Can I also just pick up some of the points that Pam Gosnell made in her summing up? Can I just pick them all up? I think we'll pick them all up and have a look at ways to do some of that, because you bring a different dynamic to the schedule of work that we've got, but we'll have a look at all of that and come back to you on that. I've also heard about the urgency of doing this and doing that with sensitivity as well. So hopefully we've got the balance right on that, but no doubt members will tell me differently, and certainly our work with the committee will help to inform that too. I've heard lots of comments today, and many of you today know that we need to take the necessary steps, both that are legislative and non-legislative, to end conversion practices in Scotland. And like Gillian Mackay and Emma Roddick, I want to send a message to our LGBTI community today. You are valued, you are not broken, and you do not need fixed. We are absolutely clear that these abhorrent and harmful discriminatory practices have no place in our society. And as Megan Gallagher told us, 13 other countries and other states have already taken these steps, and we will look at all of those for learning and understanding to get our law right for the people of Scotland. We will take into consideration the recommendations of the expert advisory group and our human rights obligations to inform our views on the steps that are needed to ban conversion practices. I understand the concerns from Willie Rennie and Emma Roddick and others on the use of the term therapy, and that's why we have changed our language in this work to practices, because I think we need to make that absolutely clear. Many, many members, through being witness to that testimony and the experiences, tell us, remind us how important this ban is for people. So, Presiding Officer, by the end of 2023, we will introduce our legislation within our devolved powers to bring forward a ban that is as comprehensive as possible, that has already been set out in our most recent programme for government and is also mirrored in the Bute House Agreement. I really look forward to seeing the advice from the expert advisory group and others, and we will build on the recommendations from the Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. Yes.
Pam Gosol.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention. Can the Minister provide assurance that different religious groups will be part of the expert group, including BAME religion groups?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, Pam Gosol and I took part in the International Women's Day event here, and we preempted each other and everything, and my next line is exactly about that work, Pam. So we also want to ensure that everyone's voice, including all of the intersections like race, faith and other communities, are expressed by Pam Gosol. So I did take a clear note of that, but I think you're absolutely right. Those intersections are incredibly important, a very important topic, and it's why, following the work of the expert advisory group, the Scottish Government will begin a full public consultation period, which will run right through autumn as well, to get as many voices as possible. I can also say to John Mason that I hear him on the need for clarity on definition and the delicate balance that needs to be struck here. We're very clear about that as well. But it's also clear that we still have a lot of work to do to ensure we build a Scotland where everyone feels safe to be themselves. The UK Government are taking forward their own measures for England and Wales only. We are committed to legislating separately in Scotland to ensure the right measures fit with what Scotland needs. Like Pam Duncan Glancy and Fulton MacGregor, I believe the UK Government's proposals don't go far enough offer the protections that I think that we want to see, but I am very keen to work with the UK Government and others to make sure that we get that right for Scotland. Collectively, we must get it right, and I'm sure everyone here will agree that we want to be on the right side of history and end this damaging practice once and for all. And as we move forward with the extremely important work, I want us to all to continue to think about why this ban is so important. The protection of those, as expressed most eloquently by Paul O'Kane in his contribution, who have experienced these insidious practices, should be at the heart of everything that we do. We need to build the necessary legislative measures to stop the practices in their tracks and ensure the appropriate resources and support is in place for those who need the help. In responding to Craig Hoy's very eloquent speech, we may not be able to change the weather in Scotland, but we can certainly make it impossible for these practices to ever happen again, so future generations will know that this was a closed chapter of Scotland's history. And being LGBTI, as Karen Adam, Gillian Mackay and Emma Roddick reminded us, is not a choice. And as Fulton MacGregor says, the use of discrimination of LGBTI people across Scotland, whether it's in the mainstream media, social media or in community settings, the responsibility on all of us is to challenge that. To do so, it is essential that we preserve and promote a society where people feel accepted and able to explore their sexuality and gender identity without feeling pressure to suppress or change who they are. Presiding Officer, I am delighted to see the cross-party support and consensus today. I sincerely believe we will reach these goals, and I am sure everyone in this chamber will play their part in achieving them, banning conversion practices in Scotland once and for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Minister, finally, I call on Maggie Chapman to wind up the debate on behalf of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee for around 8 minutes, please, Ms Chapman.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to close this debate on behalf of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. And I thank Jo Fitzpatrick and all of my fellow committee members for their thoughtful work on this issue and their contributions in this debate this afternoon. I am very grateful to all of the witnesses who gave evidence to the committee, in person, virtually or in writing. In particular, special thanks to the victims and survivors who shared their experiences of conversion practices with us. Your stories were harrowing to hear, and we recognise the courage this took. I think the committee can be rightfully proud of the inquiry that led to the published report, the production of which Clarks and others so expertly supported. It is significant, I think, that the committee unanimously agreed that conversion practices are abhorrent and not acceptable in Scotland and that they should be banned. I am pleased that contributions from colleagues around the chamber this afternoon concur, and I thank Willie Rennie and others for their kind words about the work of the committee. Presiding Officer, there are a couple of issues that I'd like to highlight, especially given the correspondence I and I'm sure many other MSPs have been receiving since the publication of the committee report. I'm grateful to all of those who have written to us to express their thoughts and concerns about the impact of a conversion therapy ban, particularly on other rights, such as rights to religion and belief. As a committee, we were conscious throughout the evidence-gathering process to hear as wide a variety of perspectives as possible, including faith leaders, advocacy groups, and NHS chaplains. A clear majority of religious organisations we heard from are in favour of a ban of conversion practices. We are of the view that legislation should not pose any restrictions on ordinary religious teaching or the right of people to take part in prayer or pastoral care, to discuss, explore, or come to terms with their identity in a non-judgmental and non-directive way, while recognising that a significant number of conversion therapy cases are conducted in religious settings and often through the medium of prayer. Paul O'Kane described being both horrified and terrified by this. I agree. And I thank Paul for his powerful contribution. We do not want to ban prayer. We do want to ban conversion practices in whatever form they take. A significant number of faith and rights experts agree with us on this, as do most faith leaders. The Global Interfaith Commission on LGBT plus lives have had almost 2,000 signatories to their declaration, which called for an end to violence against LGBTQI plus people and a global ban on conversion therapy. Signatories include 14 archbishops, 78 bishops, 100 rabbis, and various religious leaders from Sikh, Muslim, Buddhist, and Hindu religions. Indeed, the UN Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Religion or Belief, Dr. Ahmed Shaheed, says, "Banning such discredited, ineffective, and unsafe practices that misguidedly try to change or suppress people's sexual orientation and gender is not a violation of the right to freedom of religion or belief under international law." We welcome this clarity that there is no conflict between freedom of religion or belief and the protection of the rights of LGBTQI plus people. I hope that this gives some comfort to Alistair Allen and John Mason and any others who have potential concerns in this area. Yes.
Alistair Allen.
In case the member thinks I have concerns, I should be clear that I did say that I consider these so-called therapies to be unacceptable and harmful.
Maggie Chapman.
For that intervention, and yes, I did hear that very, very clearly, but I just noted your intervention in one of the earlier speeches. As legislation proceeds, we are assured by what we've heard today that the Parliament will work with faith communities and organisations to ensure that in protecting LGBTQI plus people from conversion practices does not impinge on people's right to practice their own faith and beliefs. However, I do want to echo something we heard repeatedly from survivors, often, where someone goes through conversion practices, including through prayer, it is not their faith or belief that motivates that. We heard from people who go through or are pressured or advised to go through conversion practices often do so because of external pressure. Even if someone volunteers or consents to conversion practice, they are often in environments where this is coerced or expected from them. Some of the most common responses to the question, why did you try and change your sexual orientation, are, because I believed that my desires were sinful, because I was ashamed of my desires, because my religious leader disapproved, because my friends or family disapproved, because it is not acceptable in my culture to be anything other than straight. We must protect Scotland's LGBTQI plus people from conversion practices in all of its forms, wherever and however it takes place. And that may mean protecting them from the coercion, pressure or force of people around them, people who love them, people in positions of power who would try and change the unchangeable and tell them that they are wrong for being who they are. I thank Craig Hoy, Karen Adam and Emma Roddick for their passionate words and such clear articulations of this. Psychological torture is not acceptable. That is why it is so important that when legislating for a comprehensive ban, we must be clear. Consent to such practices can never be informed and should not be available as a defence to those undertaking conversion practices, as Pam Duncan Glancy, Alexander Stewart and others have stated. We need to ensure that the legislation that is introduced is appropriately enforced too, as Pam Gosell and others have noted. I'd like to pick up on another key issue. The committee is clear that legislation alone is not enough to address conversion practices. We need non-legislative measures too in order to protect and support victims and survivors. Such measures should include, but not necessarily be limited to, education and awareness raising across different parts of society, mental health support services for those who have experienced conversion practices, a helpline and a whistleblowing mechanism. And we should consider a separate and distinct reporting mechanism for children. The Minister outlined the process that will be undertaken by the expert advisory group, and I thank her for that, and for the Scottish Government's responses to the committee's recommendations. I would stress, however, as others have done, that we need to move swiftly now. And we must act to bring forward a comprehensive ban via a process that does not re-traumatise victims and survivors who have already told their stories, and one that does not duplicate the work that the committee has already undertaken. I know the committee is keen to work closely with the Scottish Government on this. Anything we can do to shorten the timescale the Minister outlined would be most welcome. In closing, Presiding Officer, I thank all colleagues for their contributions this afternoon, for their passion, conviction and commitment to getting this ban enforced. I'd like to speak directly to all LGBTQI plus people, repeating Gillian Mackay's powerful words. You are not broken. You are not sick. You are not wrong. You do not need fixed or cured or converted because who you are is perfect. We will protect you from those who would try and change you. Let us make good on those words and act. Thank you.
Thank you. And that concludes the debate on ending conversion practices. And it is now time to move on to the next item of business. And prior to doing so, can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus.